technology and people are inseparable nowadays. Whether it is about education, entertainment,
PPAP,
health, military, anything electronics around us. Sure, it benefits us all, but when technology goes wrong, here's a smartphone, I'm going to charge it to the power outlet overnight, and suddenly it goes boom. So, who should be blamed for this? Responsible for it? Ooh, based on informatics and professional responsibility,
I am not to blame. It was computer error. No program can be proven error-free.
This is Fred. He's a computer consultant. He made a quality computer system for Newland's company. He made a complex accounting system and emits a lot of overhead. This is Jim Neville, he's a local manager. Fred and Jim are going to discuss about a new system. The upper level management heard this and discussed that they will not invest anymore on the system. Due to adequate interface, the original expensive program had to be used. Who is responsible? There are two primary reasons for this. The first one is ethical neutrality, and the second one is diffuse responsibility. Errors grounded in misinterpretation of responsibility. Diffuse responsibility. The second sidestep error is best understood using a malpractice model, which relates responsibility to legal blame and liability. Back to the part when Jim's accounting system rejected. This is Joanna. She's the one who designed the interface screen. Back to Joy and Case, the employer was Brett, the client was Jim, the users were the uncle and clerk. Because she stood in different relations to each of these parties, she owed them different and perhaps conflicting obligations. There are two types of responsibility, which are technically based and based on values. Positive responsibility points both forward and backward. It points backward when it identifies unmet obligations and what people ought to have done. Fred had an obligation to meet with the clerks to understand the structure of the interface they would need. Responsibility is more than just blame. There should also be some lessons learned from the failures of responsibility. Thus, there should be some lessons learned from the inadequate interface case. As a result of this event, Fred is responsible for preventing similar system development failures in the future. In a profession, the members pledge to use their skills for the good of society and not to merely act as agents for the client doing whatever a client asks. This commitment is generally embodied in a professional organization's code of ethics. To be a professional, one assumes another layer of responsibility beyond what has been described in positive responsibility. For example, a plumber is responsible that the results of his work will not injure his customers or users of the plumbing system. But a plumber does not bear the responsibility to advise the customer of potential negative impacts a new system may have on the customer business. The concern to maximize the positive effects for those affected goes beyond mere due care, mere avoidance of direct harm. The addition of this layer of responsibility to positive responsibility is what is necessary to change a competing practitioner into a competing professional. Cut to the chase, this sense of responsibility provides a way to address distributed responsibility as well as diffusion of collective responsibility. The ability to deal with collective responsibility is important because it enables meaningful discussion of the professional responsibility. It's clear that the competing disasters mentioned at the beginning of this video will not have occurred if competent practitioners understood and adopted the positive sense of professional responsibility.